on this week's GTA 5 O'Clock. Huge heist preview from our hands-on with the new mode. A full breakdown of the Humane Labs heist from beginning to end. Plus, information on how you and your crew can earn 10 million GTA dollars. It's all here on this week's GTA 5 O'Clock.
Two teams. Ground crew is going to jump into the labs, make their way toward the information we're after, coordinate an evac. Chopper crew deals with incoming security teams. Are we clear?
Hello and welcome to this special edition of GTA 5 O'Clock. I'm your host, James Jarvis, and I'm joined by Dan Dawkins.
Hello there.
Hello, Dan. So, big news is we've been to see Heists. We've played one from beginning to end. We've got lots of new stuff coming up. It's very exciting.
Yeah, we're going to break down the third of the five available heists that are coming out on March the 10th next week for the spectacular price of free.
Free.
So before you start griping, it's free. Loads to talk about in today's show. Before we start, I'd also like to say hello to everyone who is listening to GTA 5 O'Clock for the first time on Games Radar, which will be the new home of GTA 5 O'Clock. So look for more updates on that on the old CVG YouTube channel and on our new home on Games Radar.
That's right. Yeah, so we've seen Heists, and what we're going to do is give you an overview. We're going to go through each mission that we played and how it works. Then we'll look at the extra game modes, which we did a little show on yesterday, and talk quickly about those new additions. But there's also some information on a special way to get you and your team 10 million GTA dollars.
Yeah, this is sensational. I think we will save that big one for later. But yeah, $10 million for the right team. Massive teamwork encouragement.
That's right. So unfortunately, we've got no new footage to show you today, but we can show you footage of where we went and describe what we did. So that's what we're going to be doing. So then up top, we're going to give you a quick overview of heists in general and then break down the heist that we did into the different sections. So as an overview, as you already know, probably players who are rank 12 and above and own a high-end apartment will get a phone call from Lester, which will then allow you to activate heists. When you accept the call and begin the heist, you become the heist leader, and then you can choose to invite other players from the lobby or your friends list or players from any previous heist that you've done into that heist. Players of any rank who have done the tutorial and Gerard's first last team standing job can then go on to play heists. And there are five in total, with the first serving as a tutorial for two players.
Yeah, it's worth pointing out that the heist leader has to pay the upfront costs for the heist. Mm. So they put a bit of sunk cost in. Now, ultimately, though, the heist leader gets to choose at the very final job. They do five setup missions, then the final heist itself. At that point, the heist leader can decide who gets what from the cut.
Yeah.
Now, the heist leader can crank their own cut up to a maximum of, I think, 55%. But they can also decide effectively who among the support crew of the four other players, or, you know, the three other players, who gets what. And you can give people literally zero.
Yeah, that's bad.
Which is quite mean. So, I mean, you wouldn't expect to be doing that, but you can do that if you wish. Now, whilst the heist leader doesn't receive cash for every setup mission, they do get like an extra amount of RP points for completing each mission. And again, the guys who are in the support crew, whilst they may get the rough ride at the very end, they will earn money for every setup mission performed.
Yeah, that's right. And when you're going through these heists, as the heist leader, it's worth pointing out that only his progress will be saved throughout that string of events. So if you get to like the fourth out of five setup missions and you're not the heist leader, and then you guys go, God, we've been playing for like 4 hours, I need to go to bed. Only the heist leader's progress will be saved, so you need to make sure that you go back in as that same team to continue from where you left off, basically. Once the mission is complete, you'll be dropped back into free roam, and then you can decide to either do the next setup mission or go off and do some other things. And all of the heists do have a sort of storyline that intertwines through them. So you have to complete them in order. So you have to do heist 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. But then once you've done them all, you can then go back to your heist planning room and choose one to go back and do a different one, like the one that you're most fond of.
Yeah, and there are incentives for going back to replay. For example, if you play an entire mission through in first person mode, you will get extra bonus, you know, from doing that. And there are other ways that encourage replay.
So talking about time is difficult because obviously we were playing it for the first time. We had to learn some new things. We had to know where we were going. I'd say each of the five setup jobs probably took us around 20 minutes to half an hour to do each.
Yeah.
And then the main heist at the end is probably slightly longer, 25, sort of 40 minutes. So you're looking at a good chunk of, I don't know, what's that, 3 hours of playtime we had?
Yeah, it felt like certainly 3 hours for a decent set of players. And, you know, you're not going to want to storm through it because a lot of the cool stuff, as we'll talk about, is off mission, during mission. There is scope to improvise and to do different things. That's the fun. So, you know, mission 3 or 5 that we played, I would say, is a 3-hour-plus job. You could probably power do it in 2 hours, but you're denying yourself the fun. Now, it's hard to extrapolate that entirely in terms of the 5 missions. We do know the first heist is effectively a kind of tutorial.
Yeah.
James will talk about more of the structure of the other 5 heists in a minute. So, you know, I think you're looking at a minimum of, let's say, between 10 to 12 to even up to 20 hours plus of raw new material from this free update.
Yeah, that's right.
And of course, with the replay value and all the other stuff you could do, it's a hugely significant piece of high caliber, you know, new content, again, for free. You know, This is fantastic. And I guess something, before we really dive into the detail of it, what I'd like to know, and I guess, you know, everyone listening would like to know is, you know, James, are heists good?
Yeah, yes, they are good. They're really fun. We had a great time playing them. The fun comes in getting 3 of your mates together and all coordinating certain aspects of it and going in, and we'll go into the details later, but there's things that you have to do in sync and you have to talk to each other and you're all going around together fighting one enemy that thankfully isn't like some other people on the internet. Like, they're all NPCs that you can go in and shoot and coordinate properly, so you don't have that unexpected addition of like a giant tank coming around the corner driven by a madman running you over. It's really fun playing with friends. Obviously, there's going to be... I take a lot of similarities from Destiny. Like, that's a great way of socializing and playing together. Mm-hmm. And it feels just like that. It feels like getting a team of 4 people together, going in, spending a good 2 hours, 3 hours together doing this one massive thing and having a laugh. Like, we had some really good times of just unexpected events, like you driving into the sea.
Yeah, I did write off a few very high-end sports vehicles by driving them into the sea and various other things. It's the incidental details, like GTA always is. But the good thing is, like James says, you're not impeded by the maniacs and lone wolves of the traditional GTA environment. I guess, you know, I'm not the most experienced GTA Online player, but every time I have played, my experience is largely that it's the Wild West. I could draw an analogue almost with... I watch a lot of The Walking Dead, where essentially the world's gone absolutely to, you know, hell in a handcart, and there's Rick Grimes and his crew doing everything they can to survive. And there's a thing in a recent episode where, you know, Rick's almost given a chance to chill out, and he sort of goes, you know, you don't know what it's like out there. It's a battle to survive, and everyone's trying to work you for an angle. And like, that just to me feels like GTA Online. Everyone wants money. They're all out for themselves. Everyone you see you think's probably going to kill you or run you over.
Yeah.
Heists don't. They set a different backdrop to play GTA Online. Now, you could play it with strangers, but I think this will ideally be played much in the same way as people play Destiny in the raids, by just crewing up with actual friends, having some fun, and working against a common enemy, as in the computer and the AI, and, you know, communicating together and the fun that happens in between.
Yeah, that's right. So as Dan says, this Humane Labs raid, which we're going to talk about, is the heist number 3 in a set of 5. Now, we're not totally sure what the other 4 are going to be. We can speculate on them. As Dan said, the first one is a tutorial one, which I can see as being a sort of small bank jobs. There were semi-references to that in the one that we played. The second one is most likely to be the prison break, I think, the one that we talked about on last week's show, the one that we've got some information on and we've seen some screenshots of. 3 is the Humane Labs. 4 and 5 are more difficult to tie down. We've seen some screenshots of helicopters and jet skis going towards the party boat. We haven't seen anything about that yet. Maybe there's something to do with that. And there's that armored truck that's being heavily surrounded by army convoys that they seem to have to take out as well. So maybe there's some kind of army element, Fort Zancudo-esque thing on another heist. I speculated last week, Dan, that might be a UFO or the jetpack that they're transporting.
Well, I mean, for regular listeners of GTA 5 O'Clock, we can all laugh, sigh, and wince together at that prospect. But If you've missed previous shows, again, do check them out on the channel. We'll put links out for you. Obviously, it's got to end. The fifth heist has to be spectacular. It's got to be huge. There has to be a big reward. Let's see. Rockstar didn't show us that. We just saw, you know, Mission 3. We do know there's also a scene where someone is driving like a black sort of sports car that looks like a sort of muscle car version of Kit from Knight Rider. And then we see that being winched away on a magnet. So obviously that is a significant part of one of the heists.
Yeah.
You know, let's see how it pans out. We haven't got long to wait.
All right. So let's kick off and go into the Humane Labs raid and break it down. So to activate all the heists, you go towards a giant H in your apartment, which is located in the planning room. If you've already got a high-end apartment, that planning room exists. There's just nothing in it. Once the heists become live, it's full of like racks of guns and outfits and a map and a big planning board. That's where you go to see all the things that you've got to do for that job. Ours was to go into a secretive research facility and come out with data. Get hold of an EMP and get it into the grounds, get a lab key and get an attack helicopter. That's a new word I've made up. Half the team will then hit the lab and the other half will hold off the security forces until it's done. There are five setup missions in total. The first two unlock simultaneously and can be completed in any order. So we had a choice to go and get some key cards or to go and get some insurgent SUVs.
Yeah, no, I was slightly mistaken when we played. I thought we were making a choice which set us off down one path that we would have to replay the entire heist to revisit. It's more of a choice of the order you attack things. So we did end up doing all of the same stuff. It's just we chose in this instance, obviously, to go first for the explosive route.
That's right.
Which was retrieving these armoured, you know, SUV-style vans. And these are they like Merryweather vans we're taking?
Yeah, so they're guarded by Merryweather security. So the prospect of the insurgents' mini heist setup that we did first was to go and grab these armoured vehicles, including a truck-mounted 50 cal, which is on the back of one of the trucks. So as a team of four, you all head out to David Quartz Quarry, where they're being used in like a live fire incident by Merryweather. And so we drove there in our sports cars. Well, we drove there reasonably quickly with some minor detours into lakes and against buildings and things. And then you get to the top of the quarry and we all got sniper rifles out and proceeded to take out the Merryweather guards.
Yeah, that was really fun. I think this is where you start to feel that sense of coordination where you start talking and go, come on, guys, you know, get your snipers out. You go to the point, I'll go here, pop him a headshot. Okay, 3, 2, 1, you do there, flank him. I'm going down, cover me. And like, it's all a little bit, I didn't think certainly at this stage, it wasn't so hard that we had to do that, but it's definitely more cool and fun when you do. And then when you start to view the heist in the context of all the additional activities and the ways you can earn bonus points, well, you know, you will get rewarded for, like, you know, not losing lives for playing it in first person. So then there is that incentive to coordinate to the nth degree. But certainly in terms of you know, finishing the missions, nothing felt significantly harder than the elements of single player, for example. You know, no. I thought it was actually relatively straightforward. But I will add, we had very highly ranked characters with a full set of weapons. Plus, we were playing alongside Rockstar employees who definitely knew what they were doing.
Yeah.
So I think there is scope to be slightly more comical and rubbish when you play it for the first time. Like, we were definitely guided.
Yeah, that's true. These setup missions feel a bit like the jobs that you do in GTA Online, like the actual Rockstar-created jobs, but they're fuller versions of those things. There's more things to do, and it's got a storyline, and you're doing things for a reason rather than just going and doing steal the drugs again. Like, there's actually a cause to do it, like this, get the SUVs, and then you use them later on in the heist. So it feels more like a complete thing. You still get the normal stuff, like 25 RP for killing every man that you kill on that thing, so you can really rack up your points. And our job was to get two of these armored trucks. One for ramming, which was like heavily armored, and the other one had the 50 cal on the back. So that's the first time that you have to split your team. You have to put two people in the one with the mounted gun and two people in the ramming machine. The first thing that we did was Dan was in the ramming machine for a while, and I was shooting some helicopters. That went well for about half the time, and then I think you got too overexcited on the ramming.
I got bored because I thought like we were doing it really easily. Like, we had to pursue effectively from the north end of the map where the quarry is back sort of towards the city, and it was quite a long old drive. Mm. And when you're driving the ramming vehicle, I mean, there isn't that much to do. Basically, it's to dodge the stuff that's trying to stop you, and that's a series of Merryweather SUVs and things. Plus, there's choppers, but you can't interact with the choppers because that's the shooting guy's job.
Yeah.
So you're just driving, and I thought it was basically quite almost boring. So I thought I'll make it more fun. I'll do more ramming. So classically, I managed to like wedge it up against three other cars, and then someone shot me through the windscreen. And then we all, and this is actually a good point to talk about the restarts. So, we got pinged back, not to the very start of the setup mission, but to the point at the quarry where we picked up the vehicle. Yeah. So the checkpointing was good. And again, you press R2 and it's a quick restart. And, you know, you're back in the game again within, oh, I don't know, like 20 seconds or something. It's pretty quick and it didn't feel intrusive at all.
No, and even for failing, you still get as the non-heist leader, which we were playing as some of the supporting characters, you still get a payout, so you still get some RP. I think we got about $2,000 for failing, which was nice. So then, the checkpoints were pretty good. But after that, we swapped roles. I drove the armored truck, and you did some shooting, which you seemed a lot more impressed and excited about.
More exciting, innit? Yeah. So I was more awake. So we did shoot a few choppers down. We did that pretty easy then, really. I actually thought, you know, it was quite a pleasant Sunday drive with machine guns and enemy choppers.
So you drive back to the drop-off point, and then that is that first one completed, which then everyone gets, like we said, chucked back out into the free roam.
Yeah.
And then it's up to the heist leader to go and set up the next stage of that heist, or decide, that's it for today, lads. We're going to go off for a little break, make sure you come back tomorrow. We'll reconvene and we'll do the next bit.
Yeah, and it forces you into a little cooldown period. It won't instantly let you activate the next set of the heist. There's a few minutes where you wait for the next phone call to go to the next stage from the heist leader. And so we just, you know, we were the three of us all together messing about in sandy shores with the firework launchers out. Just, you know, like you do. Not trying to kill each other, but just scare each other with stupid stuff. So it's classic stuff. So you see like a biker will come past, one of you gets bored, hits a firework launcher into his bike. The guy gets pissed, pulls out a pistol. Suddenly, it's like a mini gang war. Next thing you knew, I shot a firework launcher into a hillbilly's face, and he exploded. And then, like off screen, you can hear like a lady going, "Holy F!" So it's just like, it's really funny. It's all that kind of stuff that really binds the experience. And there's something about, you know, when you finish a mission, if you're all injured, you all emerge into the free roam, like covered in blood in your gear.
Gunshot wounds.
And it's this weird bonding experience of, oh, we've lived through this thing together. Let's have a little mess about and get serious for the next bit. And I think it's the joins, which is what makes the heist feel special, I think.
Yeah. So the next setup mission that we did was the obtaining the key codes, which was to meet a contact in downtown to get the key codes for the Humane Labs. We had to set up lookouts and security in case of any interruptions that were happening. So this was a case of driving to a location, which I think was not a multi-story parking lot, but like a little like off the street car park, which had some 2 points where two lookouts had to go. There was a north and a south one. And then as part of the team, there's a buyer and a bodyguard who goes with the buyer to make sure the deal goes all right. So we headed off to the meeting point, and I think me and you, Dan, were the lookouts. We went up, made sure nothing bad was going down.
Yeah, and we sort of like, if you imagine a big square car park, someone's kind of in the bottom right-hand corner, someone's up on the sort of the top left corner, so you're flanking either side of the actual meet. You two guys go down to do the switch over, and you just take point. Now, this being GTA, obviously every switch over turns into a gunfight. Yeah. So then it turns into a switch over. Oh, look, it's gone bad. And then it's just a big shootout with guys pouring in either side of the rectangle.
Yeah, they're FIB guys as well. They are angry men. This is one of the setup jobs where you'll meet a returning character from GTA 5. These are peppered throughout the heist stuff. So there's a nice little callbacks to the main game in there as well. Yeah. So the FIB turn up. You have a giant shootout with them. Two people grab the briefcase and run off back to your hideout. And me and Dan stayed back and dealt with the FIB and made sure that they were all dead.
Oh, brutal justice delivered. Now, something that's worth pointing out is that when you set up for each heist mission, you get like the classic GTA Online mission screen where you get to buy all your armor. You get to buy ammo. Mm. And the really fun bit is you get to choose outfits and masks. Now, there are multiple variations of these, which are kind of tailored for the job in hand. So say your job is lookout. You might have, things like standard business suits or industrial sort of suits, or you might have more like heavy armor style suits. But if you're doing a bike escape mission, you've got more like a choice of leathers. Mm. And it's quite funny because you can really go from, you know, at one extreme, you can wear a sort of 70s Playboy Dickie bow suit for a mission, which is pretty funny, or you can wear like a sleeveless leather jacket and go for the kind of, you know, what you call them, Lost and Damned style look as well. So there's so many options in terms of your actual outfits. Equally to masks, like you can wear classic sort of Army of Two style skull masks,
like hockey masks and things like that. Yeah,
yeah, hockey masks. You can wear weird and slightly scary black plastic baby masks. That's weird. And then you can wear like balaclavas, obviously, but even they come in like five different varieties. Mm. So you've got like sort of standard classic terrorist style, I suppose, or, you know, but then you've also got designer balaclavas. So there's like a Didier Saxe balaclava with a DS on it, and it's all white and it's quite cool. Mm. It's like, if, you know, if Kanye West was a gangster, he might wear that. Obviously he isn't.
No.
I must stress that, no, but it's a kind of cool thing, you know. And there's all these different options, and that's kind of part of the fun, because each of your crew then feels unique, and there's a comedy in, like, two of you guys are dressed serious, straight-back businessmen, and two are just, like, clowns in plastic baby masks. And again, this is another layer of fun that adds to the experience.
Yeah, that bit is really cool. And you can see those outfits changing in front of you while you're waiting for other people to ready up as well. So you can be like, Dan will put on the white balaclava and we'll be like, no, Dan, that's not appropriate for the stealth mission we're about to go on. So once we had got the briefcase back to the apartment, that was basically the end of that bit, which then unlocks the third stage of these heist setup missions, which was to get an EMP. Now, this is the one that we've all been waiting for. This is the one that involves the Hydra. It's get an electromagnetic pulse to shut down the power. It's currently installed in a Hydra jet. The Hydra jet is located on an aircraft carrier. This is the one that we all wanted to play. We've been looking forward to the Hydra for ages. So the setup for this was to travel from our apartment to El Burro Heights and getting a dinghy, which then headed off to the aircraft carrier, which I think was located southeast of the city, like just off the port. Dan drove the dinghy and then moaned about the dinghy speed.
Yeah, a couple of things. We drove to the seashore to pick up the boat. I thought it would be cool and funny to drive somebody's Infernus like at high speed towards the sea, where I thought I'm going to dive out and, like, you know, meet the gang. So I was late to the party, roll out of the car and sort of appear in the middle. And I'm like, hey, you guys, which I did do. But what I forgot was the Infernus rolled out really far into the sea. Yeah. So I basically wrote off one of the guys' £500,000 cars. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
But it was pretty funny. And then you lose that car for the next round until you reclaim it or get the insurance. Then, like, we drove the boat out, which is like classic speedboat dinghy. Shows off all the PS4 waves and the motion. Mm. It was pretty bouncy. It was like kind of driving a bouncy ball. But even that's pretty funny. And you can, like, pop into first person while you're driving and look at each other and look out onto the sea. And, you know, and like all of GTA, it's all about the framing. So, like, you know, you're doing this at night. The stars are twinkling. The moon's rippling off the waves. You know, it's a really moody feel, like in this sense of like anticipation that we're going to go in and do this job. And eventually, you know, you bomb along the waves and you can see this huge military aircraft carrier coming up. The little dot on the radar directs you to the rear of the carrier. And it's a case of sort of skidding and bouncing in the night, feeling like a big SWAT team.
Yeah.
And you dock in like as a rear entrance to the carrier itself.
And like you say, the whole environment of it... The whole environment of it is great. Like, even when you're approaching the aircraft carrier, you can see like jet planes taking off and doing little routines and landing on it again as you're approaching. So it really adds to that sense of that it's an actual working thing rather than just something that's been plunked in the world. So as you get on the aircraft carrier at the back, I think we had two lives as a team for this. So you're only allowed to die twice between the four of you. Otherwise, you have to restart from the checkpoint. That happened a few times during this mission because this is a big shootout from beginning to end. You get in the giant aircraft, and it's massive, this aircraft carrier. It's not just like a tiny like corridor shooter thing. Like, there's giant hangars in there. I think you run past about six or seven planes, like, just on the lower deck before you go up to the upper deck. So we died a few times to test the restart checkpoints again. They're pretty good. They start you back on the aircraft carrier. And then it was a case of running up to the top deck and getting in a Hydra jet while the other members of the team get in regular jets. Dan, you went off to do the Hydra jet first after a bit of communication between the team of who's going to fly it. We decided you should fly it. That went well, I think.
Well, it didn't go so well at the start, let's be clear. Like, the VTOL Hydra jet, you know, it's like it sounds, you know, it allows you to toggle between standard flight mode and like a sort of hover mode.
Yeah.
Now, to take off, it's probably more fun to take off with the hover mode.
Of course.
Now, to do that, you tap right on the D-pad, which switches between standard flight and the sort of VTOL mode. Now, to begin with, I kept pressing the wrong button and kept inching forward and almost fell off the edge of the aircraft carrier.
There were shouts of, why is it doing that, as you went into the sea.
It was making me pretty angry. I kept pressing R2 to feather forward, and it wasn't going up, it was just going forward. And it's like, oh, God. So, but eventually we got up in the air, and on our first attempt, you know, again, relearning the controls, like an idiot, I kept the landing gear up and then moaned about how bad the handling was.
How wobbly it was.
Yeah, and it took, you know, put the landing gear up, and oh my God, it's like a different plane. And then you're in a basically, you know, what becomes a giant air-to-air battle of jet planes. As the enemy planes come in to take out your team of four, one of you is in the Hydra that cannot be lost. And then the other three are support. But, you know, I think, again, I probably got too excited and too engaged with the frontline battle. And I think in our first attempt, managed to, like, effectively headbutt another plane front on. Because I was just spinning around, not really taking, you know, account of the space around me. And that was quite bad. And, in fact, I think we had several goes at getting this right. It's quite tricky. And it also is an interesting point that in each of these setups, You as a team, between the four of you, you've got, what, two lives you can use?
Yeah.
So basically you're allowed one person to die once. That's cool, that's fine. But then the next death means it's mission over.
Yeah, so wipe and you have to start back at the checkpoint.
So there isn't much leeway. So we definitely exploited that a few times. When you're up in the air, it's flipping rad. Like, you know, there's the four of you, you're coordinating. Now, I don't know if I want to spoil what happens in terms of the soundtrack, but it gives you some big sounds.
Yeah.
So when you're up in the air, like, it's the song you would want to be playing when you're locked in an aerial jet duel plays, and it just feels completely badass. Like, I could spoil it, I still might, but I think it's good for you to have that moment like we did and just go, oh, yeah.
Yeah, so when you're up in the air and you're fighting this giant dogfight, really, there's a load of planes are scrambled out of Fort Zancudo and they come to head you off from stealing this Hydra. As Dan said, the Hydra can't be destroyed, but the other planes can, and then you can get back in another jet, as long as you've got enough lives, and carry on. And then, yeah, when you finish it, the radio kicks in, and you're in the air, and a song comes on. And it's much like, I would say, the moment in Vice City when you get on a bike and Billie Jean starts playing.
Yeah.
And it's like that kind of like, oh, this is like perfect. Perfect flying music.
Great accidental on purpose synchrony moment where you're like, this is just couldn't be sweeter. And then, you know, you've got to fly the jets in to land at Sandy Shores Airfield just to drop them off. Just to drop them off. Now, again, you know, landing a plane's quite easy, isn't it? Well, like it was. And like we actually did get all of the jets down nice and easy. But again, I think James had gone ahead, landed, and probably got bored, right? explain what happened, because this all went wrong, didn't
what it? What was happening was, the landing was tricky as it was, because there was two of us coming in from north and south the runway. So we crossed paths during landing.
Yeah.
And then I think we were waiting for, I think, just for you to put the Hydra in the hangar. You have to drive the Hydra into the hangar at the end to finish the mission. So all the planes were like on the ground. And then I was doing like an Austin Powers turning of my plane really slowly, turned it round, and it was nighttime and we'd all landed. So like
don't play the nighttime
lights going on. So I sort of taxied back down the runway towards where I thought everyone was going to be. And it turned out there were like three or four planes just sitting on the runway, and I may have accelerated my jet into them and blew everyone up.
So, yeah. So I've landed the Hydra. The mission's finished. All we're doing is ticking the boxes.
Ah, but the mission wasn't finished.
Well, it was as good as finished. We'd done all the dangerous bit. And then I look around from the Hydra as I go to taxi it into the main hangar. And there's James screaming down the runway, the wrong way down the runway, towards our two guys in their planes. Like, what are you doing, you maniac? Next thing you know, it's flames, explosions. We had to start entirely from the checkpoint again.
Yeah.
Maybe he just loved the shooting. Maybe he loved the soundtrack. Hey, we did it on the next go.
It was fine. It was just a test, you know. It was just a bit of fun. I wanted to fly the Hydra for a bit, so we all had to swap around. But that bit was a standout setup mission. That bit was really fun. And obviously, having the aircraft carrying there added something brand new as well. So it was really good experience. So once you finish that, the final two heist setup missions unlock. Again, like the first two, these can be played in any order. It doesn't matter which one you choose. And you've got a choice of a Valkyrie, which is a new weaponized attack helicopter, or to deliver the EMP using the LAPVs that you've got earlier from the Insurgents mission. We chose, obviously, the one that we thought was going to cause the most carnage in the Valkyrie mission. Yeah. So it starts much like the other ones. You start in the apartment, and the description is, a Valkyrie is a fully weaponized attack helicopter stationed in the port of LS. It's heavily guarded by Meriwether forces, but there are a range of optional routes to the target, including by sea. Crews will need a pilot, a co-pilot, and two gunners. So the Valkyrie is a new chopper in the game. This is one of the things I expect that will unlock as you play through the heists, much like the Hydra and other cars that you'll see.
You do open these up for free play within GTA Online as you do this.
Yeah, the Valkyrie is great. It's got two guns on either side and a front-mounted gun with like explosive rounds. So everyone apart from the pilot is shooting. And you have to basically go to the port and extract this helicopter. There are two ways to do it. You can go in the front or around the back, or, you know, on land or on sea. So you do get a choice in this mission to decide how you're going to approach it. We chose the bombastic land option. So you basically drive to the warehouse as a crew, and then you have to fight through the port. I think you would have seen it before if you've been to the port and had a little wander around. Mm. It's by all the containers and things like that. And there's just a helicopter at the back that you have to go in and get. This one's quite tricky because there was a lot of armed Meriwether patrols and snipers and gunmen and stuff. So it's a pretty explosive type of extraction.
Yeah, and the cover's a bit sporadic. Like, you're ducking behind huge metallic posts, boxes, crates. But there's lots of free ground where you've got to sprint between. And it's quite easy to get caught by guards up above or groups. They're all really heavily armed. A lot of them are wearing body armor, so it's kind of got to be headshots for takedowns. It's very easy to get caught out, like, not reloading. And then suddenly someone jump out on you and having your gun jam. And you're like, eee! And that's where you're relying on someone behind you to have your back. And, like, it wasn't, you know, the hardest thing I've ever played, but it's like, it's definitely challenging and it's fun. And it's just a good classic shooting moment.
Yeah, we should say we were playing all of these missions on normal. There is, once you've completed it, a hard option. And then there's another stage of that, which we'll talk about at the end.
Yep.
It's like an extreme option. So what actually happened was, as we were fighting through the port, one of our team died, but they died just as we were at the helicopter. So we all just decided to get in the chopper and then sort of fly up and pick them up during the middle of a gunfight.
Yeah, because we hadn't ruined the mission. We still had one life left. So that person was like, hey, you guys, where have you gone? So they spawned outside the building and we kind of had to swoop in our newly acquired chopper to pick them up, which again felt like a really cool moment. And you had to coordinate on the headsets. You know, when we played, and this did make it a bit, is we played in a sort of local area network setup. So we did all sit around four screens side by side. So definitely the human interaction adds a layer to it. But equally, you know, if you're playing with your friends over headsets, it would work really, really cool.
Yeah. So that bit was really good. And so we got to experience some of the new shooting options from the new Valkyrie helicopter. We took off. And then you just fly back to Sandy Shores, which is, and land at the area where the dancing hillbilly is. Like, he's got the pig around him. You'll know it if you've played GTA Online. Yeah. You go and land there, and that is the end of the drop-off mission. And then you've just got one final thing to do, which is deliver the EMP. So this is the fifth section of the setup heists, and it's to get the EMP into the Humane Labs so it can be triggered during the raid when you finally come back and do the giant heist. So it's fitted into the back of the LAPV. You've just got to go into the lab and store it in there without drawing attention. This is quite cool because you can see the thing in the back of the truck.
Yeah, the EMP is like, it looks like a mistake, almost like we put a disco ball in the back of the van.
It's not very subtle, is it?
No, but there's like a big, giant, glowing EMP bomb in the back of your SUV as you're driving in, so that's pretty funny. We did have a pretty... This is one of my favourite bits of, you know, when we played it. But we had a funny moment. Is we're driving in and we're all discussing how we're going to do it. And we all got our stealth equipment and we're going to snipe our way in and use the scopes and silencers. And like one of our guys was like in first person mode and I popped into first person. So we're looking at each other in the back seat. And then he just looks to me and like flips me the bird.
Yeah.
Because if you disarm all your weapons and like go to shoot, he just flips the bird. So then I started doing back the same to him. And the other passenger in the front seat turns around and starts flipping the bird. So we're all flipping the bird to each other. Then we were like, okay, this is fun and quite juvenile, flipping the bird to each other. Let's flip the bird all at the driver all at once. So rather than coordinating a headshot, we were like, 3, 2, 1, mark! And then it's on the mark. We all went, whoop! Skip the driver the finger. And it sounds like it's stupid. It's completely idiotic. It was really funny. Like, it's that kind of stupid stuff. It just enlivens the off moments in the game. And I thought that was super fun.
Yeah, it's those kind of bits and just having a laugh during one of these missions that really makes all of these experiences. It's just a thing that, you know, when you tell it to people, they're a bit like, oh, that sounds a bit stupid.
Yeah, it sounds a bit rubbish. But you had to be there, etc. Yeah. But it was great and it's definitely what binds it. Now, approaching the base itself is really fun because you've got to, like, you know, it's got to be silent, it's got to be stealthy. You definitely don't want anyone to trip the alarm. Mm. So it is a case of like, okay, park the car, we're going to stand a distance off. Two of you go on the hillside. Right, who's got the guy on the right? I've got him. Who've you got? Guy by the post. 3, 2, 1. Mark! Two headshots down. You're like, yeah!
Yeah, yeah, it's very much like a, you know, like if you watch a film where there's army SAS people going into a base and they're all stealthily taking out the guards, you're like, yeah, we feel super cool now. We're like, we could do this all the time. Where in fact, that if you miss a shot, you look like an amateur. But we didn't do that, actually. This one went really well.
Seamlessly. So maybe it seemed easier than it was. Like, there's a bit then where a van comes out of the patrol gates and a driver comes in. And he obviously can see the other guy's dead. And there's a little moment of, oh, my God, he might trip the alarm. So we just signed one of our team purely to watch for this guy. Now, again, massive caveat here. We knew that was going to happen because we were with the Rockstar guys.
Yeah.
If we didn't, I think would have caused a moment of hot panic. We'd have been like, oh my God, you've got to snipe the driver.
Someone would have got a rocket launcher out and that would have been it.
I got him. I've got him. Like, oh no. But, I mean, that in itself would have been a funny story, but we managed to get through the gates and over completely stealthily. Now, funnily enough, like, one of our guys tried to, as the gate was rising up, tried to jump over it. But somehow, like mid-jump, as the gate was rising, he got stuck between his legs and he got like hoisted like about 20 foot up in the air and like yonked.
Yeah.
Completely fine, but just again, a stupid, funny little physics moment.
So from there, you head on in into the Humane Labs. You run in and you have to obviously drive your truck in that's got the EMP in it. So three of us went ahead to take out some of the guards. There was more synchronized headshots as we moved up through the labs. The car came in very stealthily, drove through the barrier and got in and parked in the parking lot. Now, to get it actually into one of the garages, you have to hack the security door, which was your job, Dan.
Yeah, that didn't go so well. There's basically like a series of 7 or 8 oscillating bars and you've got to like press the button as the bars align with the central pattern. So they go up and down, you're like, dick, dick. And sometimes you do it and you're like, this is just so easy. You're just doing like 1, 2, 3, di, di, di. But when you get one wrong, And your instinct is, I'll just quickly get back to where I was by pressing the thing. Oh, I've done it wrong. And you keep, every time you get it wrong, you unlock the ones you've done.
So you'll have to start again.
You could go from like having 6 out of 7 unlocked. But if you get the final one wrong, it bounces you back to 5. That could quickly go to 4, 3, 2.
Right.
Everyone's watching like, what are you doing, dummy? But we did it with like a few seconds to spare. But it was a bit.
Is that bit on a timer for you?
Yeah, I think there's like a 2-minute timer or something.
Because the rest of the team don't see that timer.
Ah.
So I was just busy pointing my gun at your head while you did that, which probably helped.
I might be wrong, but it felt like a very generous time limit. Maybe it wasn't, but I felt like it was a time limit. And you definitely feel the pressure because you don't want to look like a doofus.
Yeah. I imagine on hard mode, that timer is significantly reduced as well.
Yeah. And that was kind of fun. It's a diversion from the standard shoot gameplay.
So then you just drive the truck into the parking garage and then get in it's like a Humane Labs supply truck. It's like a normal thing that you see driving around the street, and you drive that out just as all the security guys are like driving back in to try and figure out what's going on, and they don't notice anything, and the EMP stays safely in the lab. And then so then you're on to the final heist. That's the 5 setup jobs. You're all ready to go. The EMP's in the Humane Labs. You've got all the equipment you need. So the description is to go to the labs and get the files, and then after the EMP is triggered, half the team goes in with night vision and the other half hold off reinforcements in the newly obtained Valkyrie attack chopper. So you have to do a bit of coordination and talking at this point. You can all see the board. You can all see what you need to do. So you've got a chopper team and a ground team. So that's split 2 people in the chopper, 2 people on the ground. And this is the point where the heist leader gets to decide how the final payout is split. Our heist leader was being very generous to us, maybe not so much to one of his colleagues.
Yeah, got 0%.
0%.
Which didn't really incentivize him, but he was forced for the purposes of the experience on our behalf to maintain a professional dignity. So you've got to choose then at which point, like 2 of you are going to go in the chopper, 2 of you are going to do the parachute job. So James and I have got 2 different perspectives on this final mission. So I basically, because I get bored, I needed to be on the ground shooting men in the face. So that's what I did. I did the on-foot attack job. Now, what's exciting, again, in terms of choosing your outfits, you get to pick those really big, heavy armor outfits, you know, the really cool ones. So I went in kind of Hurt Locker style, which I thought was quite exciting.
So on our way to the Humane Labs, you have to go from your apartment to get in the helicopter. We had a little impromptu race on the way as well. That was sort of fun. You all get in your infurnaces and drive to it's the location where you dropped off the helicopter. So it's the same hillbilly Sandy Shores area. The race went quite well for me. I think I was 1st or 2nd, not so well for you. I think there was some complications with it being skiddy or something.
It was wet and I had a car that was a bit skiddy. But, you know, it's fun. It's a way to add a bit of life and competition to the bits between missions again, you know. So you set up an impromptu race, first guy at the checkpoint to start the final heist wins the props of the race, you know, that's it.
Yeah, so then once you're at the helicopter, you take off and you fly high up in the sky towards Humane Labs. If you're in the front, as like using the new one of the new guns, you can press right on the D-pad to see the like gunner's camera. So if you're the pilot, you can try and turn the helicopter in the right way so he can see what he's firing at later on, which is quite important. So then you fly to the top of the Humane Labs and the 2 ground teams people jump out and parachute down to the ground. So this is where me and Dan split in our view of what happened. I was piloting the chopper, so I just see them jump out and then 2 of you jump down onto the ground.
Yeah, so obviously it's classic parachute jump. Again, I was probably overly cautious and like activated the parachute.
Immediately.
So I spent about like what felt like an hour gently drifting down. My colleague just went in like complete dive bomb, free fall style, and at the very last second whipped in the parachute. I think that's the best approach because you hit your mark really tight and quick. Also watch out, you don't drift and land outside of the fence. Then you end up with a ridiculously long walk back to where you should be. But yeah, it's a fairly easy job. You get outside, you land, you take your chutes off, you're outside the lab, there's 2 big bay entry doors, and then your guys flip automatically into night vision. So the entire game turns sort of green and black, and you can see that little bit from the trailers. Then you've got to, as the two of you, like, blow open the security pad to open one of the doors, which you just do by lobbing a sticky on it or something similar, explosive. Thing opens, your guys charge in. When I say charge, like, the controls sort of slightly change, so that when you're walking forward, he's sort of striding, got the guns permanently out.
Right.
Then you press X and you enter a sort of pacey stride. So it's a real run and gun section. And when you're inside the main hangar in the carrier, guys just keep popping out in front of you in heavy armor. They've got shotguns. Like, you know, the Rockstar guy with this got completely taken out on like a blind bend of a corridor as he was coming through. Sweeps around, the guy just shotguns his face. So I had to kind of hold the fort while but we did it, you know, and he, while he, you know, regrouped and got back to where he should be. And so that entire section is kind of you breaking into the science lab, and then it's like, you know, a night vision attack, sweeping through corridors at right angles, and you're heading towards a point where eventually the two of you reach the lab, and you've both got to flip key cards exactly the same time. So you've got to, like, one guy stands on the right, one on the left. So it's like, you know, again, 3, 2, 1, card! Really generous timing.
Yeah.
But then, you know, you pop in, and that causes a mini cutscene where you grab the files you need, and then you've got to blast your way out of the lab then. So while we're doing that, what's happening up in the air?
So I'm up in the sky, and one of the great things about this is as you parachute in, the EMP goes off, obviously, which is why you need your night vision because all the lights are off.
Ah.
But if you're up in the sky, you can see the entire area. It's not just the Humane Labs. Like, all completely goes black because it's at night. So all the lights go off, and you're just there up in the sky, and you can see, like, the whole, it doesn't quite extend to the city,
yeah,
but it's like all the streetlights and things, suddenly it just goes dark, and you're like, oh, that's pretty cool.
Oh, wow, I didn't realise that. That's amazing.
So then you guys, yeah, go in with your night vision, and obviously then the security guys at the Humane Labs are pretty sure that something's going on. So they drive in a load of armoured trucks. There's a load of men that start running out of the labs. There's attack choppers in the sky, so it was my job to spin the helicopter around while keeping it near the Humane Labs area to pick up you guys once you'd finished running and gunning your way through. So it was maneuver the helicopter around so the gunner can shoot all of the incoming attack helicopters. That didn't go so well the first time, because having the new gun on the front of the helicopter makes it, it's a different experience to having it from one of the side guns, because it's a different way of turning the chopper with the L1 and L2, R1 buttons to
yep.
sort of spin it around. So there's a lot of coordination in this bit. It's coordinating you and your gunner about where you need to turn the chopper so he can see what he's shooting at and not get shot by the homing missiles that other choppers are firing at you, and try and stay in an area for when you guys have finished hacking into all the panels. So there's a lot of like, are you guys done yet? Are you guys done yet? Really need you to be finished now. And you get out and you're like, yeah, we're nearly done. It's like, well, oh, come on. So that was really good. And then you basically keep taking out these helicopters until the two guys on the ground break out, and then you have to fire a flare to let us know where you are.
From our perspective, what happens before then is after we sort of shot our way out of the lab, we break into a room which has got like an underwater access hatch. So what we had to do was like pop off our night vision, plug in the rebreather, which is a new piece of kit you get open for the entire game. Basically, it's like an aquatic underwater breathing device, so you can just swim without having to come up for air.
Right, yeah.
So then we have to swim our way out of the base through the tunnels underground. You know, it's just a basically like a James Bond-esque.
Is it the same tunnel that you go in the single player?
Oh, blimey. It could be. I think it was a different perspective. But then you eventually emerge out, you know, into the actual sea.
Yeah.
Like, phew, you're out. And that's where we swim to shore. And, you know, you sort of slowly wake your way up. You make your way out. You see the light of the sea shimmering. It's beautiful. And we make our way to the shore, pop out the flare gun, which is another new piece of kit. And you flare it into the sky. And then your guys, you know, you can actually see the flare. And then they're like, there they are. Pick them up.
Yeah. Yeah. So then I have to, like, take the chopper down to, it's like, it's a really tight, it's like a cove, really small area where they're waiting to be picked up. Land the chopper, the guys get in. So now we've got two gunners on the left and the right hand side and a gunner at the front. You take off, more attack choppers come in, and you have to take out all the choppers with your guys shooting at them. that bit is difficult because there's a lot of helicopters. There's people in the back going like, oh, spin me round to the right. And there's a guy at the front going, I can't see anything. And so you really have to sort of go, like, you take the left, you take the right. This guy at the front with his explosive rounds will try and shoot all the choppers out. So that bit's really fun and exciting. We were wobbling around, taking some head-on shots. The helicopter was on fire. It was, like, smoking. But we managed to do that. And then you fly back to the dam for, like, a debrief, basically, where you go in and meet your contact and you land and you go, here are the codes. That's all done. And then they say, like, well, we're going to have to destroy some of the evidence. So you get a little cutscene of all four of you, like, walking off as they throw, like, a sticky on the chopper and then it explodes.
Yeah.
And that's the end of the heist.
And then it pops you out in a vanilla unicorn.
Of course.
So obviously you're there for drinks and, you know, a particular type of good time, should you so wish.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's cool. That feels like quite a good moment because you do really feel like in those 2 hours you've been playing, or 3 hours, like you've been through a bit of a experience together, and there's lots of like little war stories within it, and it's a fun bonding moment.
Yeah.
And like, you know, I really enjoyed it.
So money-wise, we got a split of like 162,000 GTA dollars. I think that was about a 20-25% split of the whole thing.
Yeah.
The heist leader got 50, and then our other colleague got zero. So depending on, I guess, how friendly you are with the people you're playing with and how nice the heist leader is going to be, that split will change. And obviously the take for each heist will change, I would imagine, depending on which number you're doing, 1 to 5. We don't know what the total payouts will be for all of them, but you can expect to get, you know, that $162,000. You get about $2,000 for each little mini heist setup that you do. So you're getting a fair whack for a good couple of hours there. So finally, there are some other modes coming as well as the GTA Online heists.
Let's talk about the big one.
The big one. We went through like some of them yesterday, but the big one that hasn't been mentioned yet is called the Criminal Mastermind Challenge. Now, this challenge rewards players with 10 million GTA dollars as a one-off bonus, so you can only get $10 million once, for completing all 5 heists in order, including all setups, with the same group of players without anyone losing a single life on hard difficulty.
Yeah, that's going to be tough, and that's going to need some replays. And if you can imagine, you're on like set up 5, you've done it all, and you're on the last minutes of the last heist, and someone's down to their last blip of energy, that is going to be an absolute nightmare. Yeah. Like, you're going to have to be so careful, so coordinated. Like, you know, I'd be staggered if anyone did that first go. And I guess, you know, we've not tried it yet. Like, I look forward to trying it. I look forward to knowing, like, how much kit we'll have to buy, how careful we'll have to be, how we coordinate, what the best tactics are. But you're going to have to be really on point to nail that. And I don't know whether hard difficulty means same volume of enemies, they're just harder to kill, or you've got less energy, or if it means literally more guards, more concerns, more troubles. I don't know. But, like, that for me is kind of thrilling because I thought, as I say, it was hard. We definitely died quite a few times in the heist, and we were definitely helped because we worked with Rockstar. But I felt they were almost a touch easier. And I compare that to, say, people playing Destiny raids. We talk about them almost heroically, like the friend, their time, hell, point, and we were down to our last few bullets and blah, blah, blah. Like, you want to get that sense of being, as a team, pushed to the limits by the game. And I think this challenge will absolutely do that. And above all, like, $10 million is a lot of money.
Yeah.
And like, even if you had to buy that with the GTA cards with real money, that's a lot of money.
Yeah.
Like, it's definitely worth a lot of virtual stroke real money.
Yeah, I can imagine a lot of things going wrong and some friendships being lost over this. Especially, like, as you say, you've done, I mean, imagine if we were doing it, we've done the perfect heist, we've got all the planes back, we've got the Hydra back, and then I accidentally fly my plane just for no reason into everyone, and then we have to start the entire thing again.
If you taxied up the runway like you did and that blew our heist record and you got started all again, we'd all be pretty furious.
Yeah.
But that's the fun of it, isn't it? That's the challenge. I really look forward to Cruz taking that on. I wonder who will be the first to crack the mastermind challenges. And even if you start that immediately with your group of 4, you're going to have to like play through all the heists once to get the hard mode, aren't you? And then it's going to be at least 24 to 48 hours from inception, I would have thought, until someone nails that.
Definitely. There's a lot of training to be done
in
that. So there are a couple of other things that we'll quickly rush through now. There are additional smaller one-time bonus payouts ranging from 100K to a million, including playing all heists in first person, completing heist finales for the first time, which you would do when you went through them.
Yeah.
And there's a couple more things in there as well. So there are little bonuses to do. Even if you've done the heists before, you can go back and do these things for extra money. As you progress through the heist, as we mentioned, you get new vehicles which become available, including the Hydra jet, the Valkyrie attack helicopter, the Insurgent with the 50 cal, which is all the things that we experienced when we were playing. You get all of them to play with in GTA Online. And there's some new equipment as well, like the night vision goggles we mentioned, the rebreather, the flare gun, new outfits, masks, t-shirts, and helmets. So all of this is coming along with heists, GTA Online, with these new features. You get some new animations as well. I think there's new point animations, the ability to email other players, and new ambient activities like destroy the vehicle, distract cops, and take down planes. So there's not just heist, there's loads of stuff. Like, this is a huge update.
Oh, it's a big, big pack. And the thing I really want to ask now is, like, we've waited a long time for heist, right? It's been almost 18 months in the reckoning we've been talking about online heist. So I remember on the show speculating, talking about them, imagining how they would work. We waited. It's almost become like an apocryphal imagination. Like, will we ever see heist? And now we have. We've played them. We've seen them. Like, how do you feel, James? Do you feel like it's been worth the wait?
I feel it definitely adds a much-needed element to GTA Online. Like, it will make me go back and play it now with, and you know, coordinate nights where you go, right, tonight we're going to do this heist and it's going to be us four, and we're going to, I think it will really help go people play GTA Online and like bond in that world rather than just go in and go, oh, I'm just going to go and shoot men and get my tank out and run everyone over and terrorize them. Like, it will really bring that social experience to it and everyone teaming together, and you know, it might make people nicer players because there's a lot of things that if you're doing it with randoms, it will encourage that cooperative team play, and
you have to
and the want to play with each other rather than kill each other all the time.
Yeah, you have to. And like, is this, you know, is it worth the wait? Well, yes, and also a little bit no, because a lot of what it is familiar, right? Like the mechanics, the driving, the flying. This is GTA. Like, you might be playing on PS4 or Xbox One, so you understand, obviously, it looks better, but you've already got used to those graphical upgrades. The game's been out a few months. It's a very familiar world, a familiar patterns of play. But a different context in terms of the fact it's co-op, it's with friends, and as James says, it echoes missions you've already done in GTA Online, but forced into a much more necessary framework. And the important thing to remember is, like, anything we've waited 18 months for, what do we really expect it to be? Like, short of them taking the missions to Vice City, Liberty City, you name it, blah, 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 what do people expect? And truthfully, right, it's free. It's free. And for free, Rockstar are giving you 20 hours of super built-out AAA extra gameplay that adds a whole new context to GTA Online. That's incredible. Like, I know a lot of people have complained about, oh, Rockstar, like, people, the extreme end, people have gone, the PS4 version, you forced me to pay for a beta test in the PS3 version, and now you've forced me to pay it again. So worst case, you paid out $100, £100 plus for the two versions of the games, but you've had relentless, GTA Online is effectively free. You don't pay for the service. You can if you want for cards. You don't have to. It's all about really what you put into it. Rockstar have given you money, they've given you incentives, and now they're giving you 20 hours, effectively, of what could be a brilliant standalone DLC pack that's easily worth $10, $15, $20, £20. You know, that's brilliant value. Like, and you've got to salute them for that. And I'm sure down the road there'll be more DLC. There will be the things we've talked about, like new locations, new spins, proper standalone DLC that will cost actual money. But for now, you're getting something worth 20 hours, whole new spin on the game. You know, hey, wow, hats off. So now the good news is that's a big episode for us. Yes. They're not always 1 hour plus long, but it's not every day we get to play a game mode 18 months in the making. If you'd like to read more about this in hopefully a more coherent form, I've got a written article on Games Radar available for your eyes, hopefully right now, because I literally haven't started writing it yet and I haven't got very long to do it. Nope. So get the apologies in early. It's going to be great. I love writing. So that'll be up on the site as well. And, you know, and do follow the channel to get more GTA 5 o'clock every week. And if you're joining from Games Radar, well, I hope you've enjoyed the show.
Yep, thanks for listening. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter at GTA V O'Clock and on Facebook at facebook.com/GTA V O'Clock. And as Dan said, if you've liked what you heard, don't forget to subscribe. And we will be back next Wednesday and every Wednesday at 5 p.m. GMT.